And of course... Yeah. So in case you guys saw pictures of the other TD event, whether it was in Mumbai or in Chennai, you know that this is actually the moment where I take off my jacket and take off my shirt, and then I'm wearing the India cricket shirt. Now, if you guys would have taken care of this one, yeah, I could have worn my shirt again today. But now the Australians are kind of getting the overhand in this. Yeah, it's not good. So who do we pick? Sri Lanka? If someone has to win, does it have to be Sri Lanka? Eh? Yeah? Okay, I'm going for that one. And they're the home country, so that would be nice. Actually, I think something that Shane said, you know, the challenge, the problem of big data, I don't think it's a challenge. It's an opportunity. Yeah? And so what I'm going to talk to you about is a bit how Amazon customers are using big data. And on one hand, we'll talk a bit about research and sort of the really advancing things that people in research are doing and how that is powered by cloud computing. But we'll also talk a bit about, you know, what are sort of the Amazon services that can help you in this world and my definitions of big data and things like that. So hopefully you can walk away with having a little bit better insight in what's happening in terms of this massive computational power, massive data crunching that's happening on the Amazon platform, as well as maybe how it applies to you and maybe how it applies to your business and why that's important. But first I want to start with sort of more talking a bit about what is big, actually. Eh? What is the big things that our customers are doing on our platform? And maybe a good place to start is... One of the famous projects that happened, that started, I think, something about 15 to 20 years ago, that was to synthesize the human genome. And the sequencing of that actually took quite a while. It took about 13 years. And really, there was a lot of money being spent on just sequencing that one genome. And the result of that was actually in the orders of gigabytes. And it was fun in those days. There were no portable USB drives. So people actually moved it around on iPods. And so the next step after that we worked on the human genome became that we were actually taking different animals and trying to sequence their genomes and use that for research in looking at how were actually all these animals or these mammals, how were they all different? And so while that gave a lot of insight and actually that generates sort of data in the orders of hundreds of gigabytes, and while it is interesting, more interesting, of course, would be to actually look at more humans. And so that was the birth of sort of the next generation of projects. And what a really important enabler was in that time was that there were new instruments coming out that could automate the sequencing of these genomes. And actually, those instruments were significantly less expensive than what we had seen before. And it suddenly became much more affordable to start sequencing genomes. What the result of that is that we start ending up with data sets that are in the order of terabytes. Yeah? And that's great because that's really what we want. But if you really want to start comparing, you need to have multiple genomes. And for that, the 1000 Genome Project was born. With the idea was, the goal was there to actually collect the genomes of 1,000 individuals and make that publicly available. Now, Amazon worked together with the National Institute of Health in the US to actually make the data that is in the 1,000 Genome Project available for all researchers, or actually for everyone who wants access to this data around the world, so that they can do research on it. And so the problem is a bit that all of this data is really complex. And computational resources required are substantial. And so it's almost impossible for hospitals or for smaller research institutes or for universities to do this research or to do the computation by themselves. So cloud is the ideal place for them because there they have access to unlimited resources. And so the state of this now is the 1,000 genomes data is available on AWS. It's well over 200 terabytes of data. Yeah, and that actually is including not just 1,000 genomes, it is 1,700 genomes at the moment, and that data set is only growing. And it's available for anyone that wants to operate it. The data set is around 200 terabytes, and it's part of the of what we call the public data set program. It is aws.amazon.com/public-data-set, and you'll find a whole range of different public data sets available for you to do research on, or to, for example, match your own data to. The second story that I would like to tell you is also it's from a different customer. This customer is called Cycle Compute, and their mission in life is to actually make science do what they're capable of. Right? Because one of the things that we see in science is that they're becoming more and more data-driven. And so Cycle Compute, what they did is actually built a 50,000-core supercomputer on top of the Amazon Web Services cloud. And so why would you need 50,000 cores? Why do you need things that are that particular big? So let us look a bit at the problem that these guys are trying to solve. They are working for a company of one of their customers is actually targeting new cancer drugs per year. They're targeting in building new cancer drugs. As you can imagine, with all the people that are getting cancer a year, about 12.5 million, it is obvious that every day is crucial and costly. So the faster we can create new cancer drugs, the more important it is, both for the individuals that have cancers, as well as for doctors, as well as for society as a whole. So what they are looking at is whether we can actually speed up the drug discovery for cancer drugs. So they're working together with a company called Schrödinger. Schrödinger is sort of the leading company in terms of computational chemistry algorithms. And these algorithms are actually, if you look at it from the outside, relatively simple. Now, what they have, you have a protein, and in this protein sits an open space. And what you would like to do is actually insert a compound or a molecule into that open space and change the behavior of that protein. Now, the way to do that is actually relatively simple. There is a lock in there. That's how you should visualize it. Then you have to find the molecule that fits into the lock. But the thing is, you actually have millions of keys. You have millions and millions of compounds that you want to try out. So this is sort of a brute force computational approach. Yeah, you are going to try millions and millions of keys that actually have to try and fit into that particular slot in the protein. So the challenge that they wanted to run a virtual screen on a very large set of proteins with 21 million keys. And what it says actually, with a higher accuracy algorithm, what Schrödinger normally would do is actually run it on-premise. They had a small HPC cluster on-premise and they would run it there. A run would take months. And because a run would take so long, they would actually do a sort of a pre-selection on sort of which things they were going to try out. Meaning that they were already running the risk to actually eliminate good leads that they could use, but they just didn't have the true computational power to do something this big. So with 21 million compounds, what Cycle Compute did is in 3 hours instantiate a 50,000 core supercomputer on AWS. And given that this is a sort of loosely coupled kind of approach to supercomputing, they could use resources from all over the world. It wasn't just that we were running this in the US. This was making use of all 8 regions of the Amazon Web Services. Yeah, so here you have a supercomputer that spans the whole world working, collaborating on finding the next cancer drugs. Now, this runs three hours. The first 2 hours, they were kind of building up to kind of having their complete set available. And then in the last hour, they were actually running with 50,000 cores. Now, 50,000 cores for 3 hours actually gives you about 110,000 hours of work. In essence, this is 12 and a half years of compute done in 3 hours. That's pretty amazing. Yeah? It only cost you $5,000 an hour. That's amazing. Because normally, this would have costed Cycle Compute $20 million if they would have even started thinking about an infrastructure that could complete these things on time. Now, I want to bring something back that we said earlier. In the kind of research that they want to do, in the kind of urgency that they have, you know, speeding up this kind of research into cancer drugs from something that takes months to something that can be done in hours is amazing. And to be honest, we are extremely humbled at Amazon that we can even contribute to this. And believe me, when we started off Amazon Web Services, we weren't thinking about actually making these kind of contributions to society. But I think that Cycle Compute is doing extremely great work on our platform, and they are really to be applauded for that. So what you see here are two examples of a big shift in science. Yeah, where the third, what's called sort of the fourth paradigm. The third paradigm was where we would have models and where we then would use data sort of to validate that the models were true. The fourth paradigm actually eliminates models. What the fourth paradigm does is it really looks at data and uses data to actually derive knowledge from it. And that is something, a statement that we will see coming back when we start talking about big data in the enterprise as well. If you're interested in this book, this is a book with a number of essays that have been written in memory of Jim Gray, a famous researcher that sort of is at the forefront of this big data movement. And if you want to download the book, it'll only cost you 99 cents in a Kindle version. Before we go to the next one, actually, I want to invite you to listen to watch a small video about NASA.
Take a few moments to learn how, in just 60 minutes, NASA can process a day's worth of new discoveries from the Mars Science Laboratory. The red plains and pink sky of Mars hint that volcanoes, meteors, and flash floods once shaped the landscape. Today, a number of robots sent by NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory explore the atmosphere and surface of Mars. These rovers are on a quest to find out whether the red planet is, or ever was, an environment able to support life. However, giving instructions to a Mars rover is more difficult than most people realize. Unfortunately, there's no joystick controller a scientist can use to move the rover around. And even at the speed of light, it still takes between 7 and 20 minutes for a transmission to go from Earth, across space, to the rover on Mars. To make matters even more complicated, there are only short periods of time in which scientists can communicate with the rover at all. This makes for a precious window of time in which NASA JPL engineers must determine the next day's mission for the rover. Sometimes they have just a few hours to download data from the rover, then process and interpret that data in order to send new mission instructions back to Mars. When they can speed up the analysis of the data, it leaves more time for science. That's why the team uses Amazon Web Services to spin up hundreds of Intel Xeon E5 processors when they're needed. With the scale and performance of this on-demand computational cluster, NASA JPL engineers are able to drive 12 teraflops of performance for less than $40 an hour. This leaves more time to work on programming Curiosity's next steps. It also enables NASA to get greater utilization of the rover's unique capabilities. Closer to home, NASA JPL scientists also use Amazon Web Services and Intel Xeon E5 processors for other computationally intensive workloads, such as robotic articulation calculations and Arctic climate analysis, all while enabling their researchers to work more productively and cost-effectively. When the team needs more computational power to support these and many other missions, they can easily provision what they need, as, and when they need it. This on-demand scalability lets NASA scientists and engineers keep their focus on exploring the Earth, the solar system, and the universe beyond.
Well, it's actually pretty exciting to be working with NASA. You know, this is all the stuff that happens there is cool. You know, there's no, you know, if there's one company I think everybody ever wants to work for as an engineer, it must be NASA. Yeah. Let me show you an image. This is a picture I took a few weeks ago when I was in Sao Paulo in Brazil. And it actually makes use of an app on my iPhone called AutoStitch. AutoStitch is for free and makes beautiful panoramas. If you don't have it on your phone, it's absolutely worthwhile in actually using it. So basically what AutoStitch do, you make a number of pictures and it stitches it together, makes a beautiful panorama. Actually, what Curiosity does is kind of similar. Yeah, because what Curiosity does is not make one picture. Actually, it makes a lot of small pictures and then uploads those images back to Earth, and there they get stitched together just like AutoStitch does. Yeah, they make sort of these quadrants, and then this is sort of a self-image of one of the arms of Curiosity, and create larger pictures out of that. This is another image. It's sort of in the distance, you can see the Curiosity is in a crater, and that in the distance there are mountains. And this is a self-portrait, and can do that as well. Now, one of the reasons for doing this auto-stitch one is that actually the camera in Curiosity only is a 2-megapixel camera. And so you should ask yourself, wow, you know, my iPhone or my Android phone already has 8 megapixels. Why did they only put a 2-megapixel camera in Curiosity? Well, they started building Curiosity in 2004. And 2-megapixel cameras were actually pretty much state-of-the-art in those days. Yeah, this is the camera that's in there, the one that's on top of the top of Curiosity, and that's a Swiss Army knife that's been next to it. So you get a bit of an idea of the sensors of that. Now, there's also another reason why they only have a 2-megapixel camera. The bandwidth between Mars and Earth is actually pretty much constrained. Yeah, there's 2 satellites that are circling around Mars, and Curiosity has a 128 kbit uplink to each of those satellites. So in reality, that means that on a daily basis, it can stream, under good circumstances, it can stream about 250 megabytes back to Earth. Yeah? And so giving it an 18 megapixel camera wouldn't actually have helped much, because it can send 4 or 5 images back then to Earth, and then all the bandwidth will be taken. That's useless. Yeah? And it's not only actually that we're powering. So what happens then, all of those images come from Mars and actually get stored in Amazon S3, in simple storage service. There you have a whole range of, on one hand, researchers that are inspecting those images and running all sorts of algorithms on it. But there's also the auto-stitching program that actually takes these images and then builds these large ones that you can see everywhere. We're not only running that sort of scientific side for them, we're also just running their website. And this is the traditional website. We also ran their website when actually Curiosity landed on Mars. And that was a major event, not just for NASA, I think for anyone that was involved in sort of the distribution of worldwide video. They were using all the different regions from AWS to distribute the video locally and then through CloudFront into the hands of anybody that wanted to see the landing of Curiosity. Well, that was pretty spectacular. Now, that was more sort of the interesting, more semi-scientific side. And actually, I think that for businesses and for enterprises, whether you're actually a young business or an established business, sort of the big data is still in the same realm. Yeah, we are starting to look at data by itself. It's not that we have a sort of a user panel and then have that user focus panel actually give us information, and then we go see whether the kind of data that we collect match what these panels said. No, we're forgetting about panels completely and actually are going directly to the data to learn more about our customers. Because in reality, that's what we want to do. And so my definition for big data, the business definition at least, is the collection and analysis of large amounts of data to create a competitive advantage. And why is that important? I think I mentioned it this morning as well. I think there's an abundance of products in the market. There's increasing competition. There is murderous competition almost. There's increasing consumer power. So it is more and more important to truly understand your customer, because you will need that to make your product successful. And so there isn't a vertical today that is not in one way or another engaged in sort of this big data, large-scale data set analytics. And whether it's targeting enterprises, or whether it is genome analysis, or whether it's finance with their Monte Carlo simulations, or whether all the sort of sentiment analysis in social networks, all of these things are happening across the board of all verticals in the industry. Now, let's look a little bit at the technology side. It's not always that you know, data needs to be very big. It can really be that the sort of, it can still be little smaller sets of data. 100 gigabytes is nothing today. But you may have compute needs that are actually substantial in that world. And for me, I also have not only a business definition of big data, I also have a technology definition. Yeah, because for me, as a technologist, big data means that you have to start innovating in the whole pipeline that makes up big data. Yeah? How do you collect the data? How do you store it? How do you organize it? How do you analyze it? And how do you share it? And each of those steps in that pipeline requires innovation to actually really meet the needs of its customers. And actually, I think there's a close match between cloud computing and big data, because in each of those steps, you need to have unlimited resources. And so look at some of the resources that we've been innovating on to actually help you in your computation and in your storage need for big data. We see an enormous rise in the amount of unstructured data. There is zettabytes of unstructured data being generated every year in sort of the digital world. Yeah? Much of those is data generated by individuals. And often it says something about those individuals. Yeah, and the expectation of that, is only in its infancy. It's going to explode the amount of data that we are actually generating. And so there's many of these different places where we see the generation of this data starting. And it's websites, of course, but the whole social graph movement, whether it's your social networks, or all the other apps that you're using that have some social component to it. And there's then all these sensor data that are actually arriving. And you may often think that sensor data is something that is industrial or things like that. I don't know how many of you have things like a Nike Fuel Band or have a pedometer like Fitbit or things like that. That's only the beginning of all these devices that we will be using that will generate data about ourselves. And all of that data needs to go somewhere. It needs to be analyzed somewhere. And it needs to be brought together to be put in context. I actually think that the mobile world is an increasing factor of how all this data is being generated. Yeah? There's more people that actually are walking around with devices that can track or can generate information. And it's actually also easier to collect because all of these devices are connected. I think there's many more directions, many more sides to data that are changing. It's more, there's more volume to it, there's more variety to it, there's more speed at which it's coming to you. All of these things are important. And plus, I think something that actually also really changed things is that we have stepped away from the old world of business intelligence. In the old world of business intelligence, which most businesses did, you on forehand already knew what kind of questions you wanted to ask. That drove the data model, and that drove the data that you collected. But here now, we have a very different world. We have a world where we start to collect as much data as possible, and then we are going to run queries and algorithms over it that are continuously refined to see what kind of information we can find in these data sets. And so what are the kind of questions that enterprises or companies are these today specifically really interested in? They really want to understand their customer, because that allows them to build better products. What is your consumer really like? Yeah, what do they like? You know, how they are really using your product? How they are moving through your website? All of these kind of things, really, truly understanding how your customers are using your products is actually at the sort of the at the origin of the whole big data movement. And one thing to realize is that the more data you are collecting, the better results you're going to get. Yeah, the more data you collect, the finer grain the result can be. And at Amazon, we know all about this. Because at Amazon, we've been, at Amazon.com, the retailer, we've been collecting data for, about customers and about products for a very long period of time. And we are actually using this sort of large amounts of data to give, for example, recommendations. And I want to give you an example, two examples actually, where if you do not have enough information, yeah, sometimes you cannot make good recommendations. The first one of this, and I'm just picking two, if you type in funny Amazon recommendations in Google, you get a whole range of things where our recommendation algorithms actually do not work very well. The one on the top is where someone bought an oil filter for his car, and we recommend that he buys an album of the Jackson 5 to go with it. Now, that's actually, that's sort of moderately funny, but the one at the bottom is more interesting. Someone put a set of Japanese steak knives on their wish list, and we recommend that he buys Windows 7. Maybe it has something to do with suicide, but I'm not really sure exactly how that really works. Yeah? So here is obvious. The thing that we should have done is not given a recommendation. Because pretty much, it's pretty certain that the reason why we give this sort of failed recommendation is that we did not have enough data. And for many of these algorithms to work, you need to have sufficient data to actually make your algorithms really work. Now, one thing in this whole of bigger is better world is that you do not know beforehand, you know, how much data am I going to collect? How many times am I going to do an analytics run before I've gotten to the refined point that I'm really getting the results that I want? And so big data needs no limits. It needs limited access to resources. And that's really the point where big data and cloud are really a match made in heaven. Yeah, because all of the storage that you need, that you want, is in the cloud, and you can run as many computational runs as you want, even sometimes, if you want, with 50,000 cores. And so it's obvious, you know, sometimes you just want one server, then you want 1,000, and then you want to go back to one. So the story here is that if you would need to do all these computational runs in your own environment, you would have to need all of these things, all of these servers, all the time. Within AWS, you can fire up any cluster that you want at any time, and then, boop, you're back to one again, or zero, if that's what you want. Only having a massive computational cluster whenever you need it, and when you no longer need it, you don't have it. So often there's this saying that, you know, a computational cluster is always too small when you need to use it, and it's always too big when you're not using it. And in the cloud, all of that is gone, because you get exactly sized computational cluster that you need. Now let's look again at this pipeline, and want to really remember you to remember that these are all sort of the different areas which are part of big data analytics. It's not just the analytics phase that you have to think about as an IT professional when you're thinking about big data. You have to take all of these into account. How are you going to get your data to the place where you want to do analytics? So how to ingest? Of course, we have a number of tools there in AWS. You have Direct Connect. You can actually put things in a FedEx box and actually ship it to us. Do not underestimate the bandwidth of a FedEx box. Yeah, there's still speed of light in networks, and there's a lot more data that can go in one of these FedEx boxes. Yeah, there's queuing tools. We have the storage gateway. There's a whole range of ways for you to actually get your data into the cloud. But often, your applications will already be running there, so you actually do not need to move it. And then, actually, you get to make decisions. You know, am I going to put it in a relational database? Am I going to put it in DynamoDB? Am I going to put it in S3, or maybe eventually you're going to put it in an archive? You know, all of these things are sort of the different databases, storage offerings that there are, and for which you need to make decisions. And especially with the archiving, and maybe that you have a 50 terabyte, including the set that you start with, the result of that is 200 terabytes of visualization data. You hand it off to some of your stakeholders. What do you do with the data? Are you going to throw it away? Yeah? You might want to do a run on it again later, but you don't need to have it online all the time. So Glacier, with its 3 to 5 hour access time, but only at a cent per gigabyte, might be the ideal solution for you to park the data for the long period of time that you actually do not need it. Now, I'm always looking at, if you look at these different kind of, what kind of decisions do you make, which one to use, access times, maybe one of those, yeah? It is obvious, DynamoDB gives you single digit millisecond access times to your database, S3 gives you sort of in the 10 to 100 millisecond access times, and Glacier takes a few hours for you to get your data back. Now, if you look at scale, all of them are the same. Yeah, all these databases, both the database DynamoDB, as well as the storage solution, Amazon S3 and Glacier, are unlimited in data. So that's a direct dimension that you do not have to worry about. And you do have to worry a bit about price, because, you know, whether, and price often is a combination between price and actually latency towards the storage option. Yeah, if you really turn up the provision IOPS on DynamoDB, that might actually is going to cost you more. Yeah? And so, but we give you the tools to exactly make of those trade-offs for yourself. Yeah, and so, if you look at the pipeline, some of the actions are actually on there. You know, how do you collect it and then where do you put it? How am I going to run my computations? And how am I actually going to share the results of these computations with others? Now, in the middle of that is the compute part. And most customers that are actually considering working on big data will use Hadoop or will use MapReduce as sort of their framework in which they are doing this computation. And most customers actually do not want to run their own MapReduce and Hadoop jobs, mostly because it actually is a lot of work. Hadoop is a distributed execution framework, and especially if to scale this one up, then you have to do a lot of work. And so we've introduced something called Amazon Elastic MapReduce, where we take care of all the grunt work, of all the muck that has to do with running MapReduce, and you can just insert your algorithms and data into this environment, and we run those jobs for you. Yeah, and so there's data often coming either out of DynamoDB or out of S3, then you run all the jobs, and then you actually get the results of that data back. It is really popular. There's a lot of, I think there's well over 2 million clusters that we have launched in the past 2 years on Amazon's Elastic MapReduce. But just as a sort of intermezzo, what is this MapReduce stuff, actually? Yeah, MapReduce is not an analytics framework by itself. It is actually a distributed execution framework. What it allows you to do is to split up the data and the work that you have on the data into smaller pieces, and then execute that work, and then have a phase after the execution of that work in which you collect that data and merge it together. So one is the map phase, which is do the original work, and then there is the reduce phase, in which actually the results of that original computation are kind of being brought together. Yeah? And they chose a sexy name for it, MapReduce. They could have called it select merge, but that was probably not too much, has too much connotation about the past of databases. But in essence, that's what happens. And to be honest, you know, there is no analytics here happening. It's just the execution of these programs. And what we see from many of our partners and many of our customers is that writing Hadoop programs is not trivial. Yeah? And so they're looking for many companies in our ecosystem, for example, to give them new sort of interfaces between higher level analytics and then to execute that program at lower level using Hadoop or MapReduce. So quickly, you know, you have input, you actually insert your code into Elastic MapReduce, that creates a name node, what's called, that's sort of in charge of the execution of the overall system. It creates a whole range of sort of the distributed environment that has split up the data over the different nodes. It makes use of a virtual file system called the Hadoop file system. And then you ask, you put queries against that environment. And then the result of that actually is output that goes back into Amazon S3. And then poof, cluster goes away again. So you're stuck with them with the input data and actually the resulting data. So for a particular customer that maybe have very large log files, you're interested in actually what this one particular individual was doing on your website. You fire up a whole cluster of Hadoop nodes using Elastic MapReduce. They execute the programs. You collect the results, you merge the results of that. You aggregate them into a sort of profile of what this one individual has actually done with your product. And then, poof, the compute environment is gone again. So, and you actually can make decisions about how long you want this to go. You can actually, because in essence at Amazon, at the Amazon Web Services, whether you run something, one instance for 100 hours, or whether you use 100 instances for 1 hour, it's identical. Yeah? Both cases will cost you $8. And of course, you can add a number zero to it. You know, one instance for 1,000 hours or 1,000 instances for 1 hour will cost you $80. Yeah, so this tool says you can make the trade-offs about how fast and how long you want to compute. Because in a distributed framework like Hadoop, you can go very wide. You can have a large number of nodes, and it just means that your work is done earlier. And it might cost you exactly the same to go wide instead of to go deep. Now, there's many of our customers that are running these clusters, and I've already given you a few. There's 2 million of them Hadoop clusters that we've launched in the past year. And there's quite some marquee names on there. So let's take a look at what some of our customers have been doing using Elastic MapReduce. Yelp is probably a service that you guys know. It's a directory service that has extensive advertisement, but also recommendations on its site. So they make use of MapReduce to, on one hand, do recommendations. I think that's on this page very well visible. But they also built, for example, reverse indices or spelling checker indices, such that if you type in a particular name with search, they will give you suggestions for how to correct it. Again, they are using MapReduce to build indices for that. Razorfish is a well-known company in the US that does analytics for customer targeting. Basically, they take in information from their customers, often from their website and from the point of sales, if there's also brick and mortar stores. And then they do analytics from that to better target customers with advertising. They were running into the problem that customers were generating so much data that they were turning themselves into a storage company. Some of their best engineers had to be put on storage because the way that their storage was growing was incredible. And actually, to be honest, their salespeople were blocked on actually getting more customers on board because they couldn't buy enough disk space to actually meet those needs. I love trains. So what Razorfish did, they actually moved on to AWS. And originally, they did this purely for storage reasons, so that they could actually take their best engineers that they had put on storage, that they could go back and actually build better algorithms for their customers. Which was really good, because actually, that year in which this happened, this was 2009, e-commerce exploded during the fourth quarter of 2009. And many of their customers were generating so much data that if they would have had to do that on-premise, they would not have been able to meet their SLAs to their customers. And now, the only thing they had to do was just fire up more Hadoop nodes, just so they could still complete all their analytics jobs on time. Shazam is a good example of a company that does lots of hardcore analytics about all sorts of music and all sorts of text that they're getting. There's a whole new site to Shazam that actually is making use of DynamoDB as well as EMR at very high scale rates to actually do computations to actually give them information about either the advertisements or the music. Climate Corporation is a very interesting new company in the US that actually provides farmers insurance. And so what they do is they do massive analytics on all the information that they have about sort of weather conditions in the past and weather conditions that are to be expected. And then they allow farmers to take an insurance on the probability of that bad weather arises. And the kind of insurance that they take is that if sort of bad weather happens and crop gets destroyed, the farmers get their income supplemented to the level that they normally would have had if their crop would have been successful. And actually, they're a pretty special insurance company because of all of these, whenever claims come in, they can just do the data analytics to understand whether this is a valid claim or not, and actually immediately, automatically pay out to the farmers without too much hassle around it. And on one hand, you can, of course, have these very serious topics, such as insurance for farmers. There's also lots of fun on our platform, of course. This is Playfish. It's a gaming company in the UK, but it has customers worldwide. And they have about 50 million customers on a daily basis. About 10 million of them are active. And they analyze on a daily basis about 500 million events. Most of those events are how are customers actually playing our games. And they want to get that very detailed information about how customers move through the games, which are the kind of spaces where they're not spending too much time on, so that they can continuously improve the games. Yeah, that's really their goal. And they own zero servers. Yeah, even for the gameplay, as well as for analytics, they run 100% on AWS. But Coupa is a company that looks at what's the kind of behavior of customers while visiting websites. They have sort of programs installed on people's desktops that allow to track themselves. And then it actually gets uploaded into Amazon SQS, which then stores it in S3. Which goes into EMR, and then the result of that is stored, of the analytics is stored in RDS. And then you get dashboards like this one, where, for example, the graph at the bottom is which newspapers are being read by which individuals at what time. And of course, we have our customers here in India as well. Rediff.com was actually one of the earliest customers that was using the Amazon Web Services. And they are also using Amazon EMR to do data mining operations to give a better user experience at their portal. Of course, one of the larger customers on our platform in the first place is Netflix. Yeah, and Netflix has about 25 million streaming customers. They generate about 50 billion events a day. Yeah, 50 billion events that they need to analyze to understand how their customers are using their service. Yeah, and they have about a petabyte of data that actually gets stored against which they make comparison. They have web logs that go in there. This is sort of the architecture that they use. All of the data comes from the individual nodes that they run, gets stored in S3. They use an EMR cluster to do sort of pulling all of those logs together, merging the logs, and then writing them back in a sort of semi-structured format into S3. And then the individual sort of business units are firing up smaller EMR clusters that operate on that data. And the smaller EMR clusters may be to do recommendations, to do systems management, to understand how we can improve the website, but also a bit, you know, how is the site operating, how is our customers doing, and what are the kind of financial things that we're seeing in our corporation. There's a lot of interest in doing second screens, but nobody knows how a second screen means. People have a tablet or a mobile device and are watching television, and then you have extra applications on your mobile device that are in complement of what you're watching on TV. Channel 4 in the UK does continuous experimentation in this world because nobody knows what second screen technology is going to be like. What is it really that customers are liking? And based on what they're seeing, they make real-time changes here. PriceMaster, Ticketmaster uses our EMR environment to, in real time, adjust pricing on basis of the competition, what's going on. And they have a quite complex set of tools built around that. And although, you know, in the past, maybe all this data analytics was the sort of the purview, the unique property of large enterprises. Today, there is not a young business being built that does not have analytics at the core of its business. Many of them are following sort of the lean startup methodology. That means you get a product in the hands of your customers, and then very quickly you iterate where they want it to go. But for that, you need to do analytics. You need to understand how your customers are using your products. SoundCloud is a good example. They recently moved from being a sort of a music sharing service, a music service where musicians put their music up, to a general platform for audio. But of course, SoundCloud itself don't know how customers are going to use this platform. And a good example is that recently, presidential candidates and other candidates in the US are using this platform to store their speeches. And so immediately when through the analytics, SoundCloud found out that was actually happening, immediately they put a bunch of business development guys on it, and now every politician in the US is storing his speeches on SoundCloud. Foursquare is something that Joe Siegler this morning already mentioned. They're a location-based service, and all the data they've been collecting is sort of input into providing better service for their customers. For example, they created this Explore tab in their app, which, based on what's close to me, what are the really cool places that you go visit, what is the coffee shop that you should go to, or what's actually a good restaurant in the neighborhood. And it's not just sort of these startups, it's large enterprises as well. And especially when it comes to sharing data. In this case, this is the Market Replay app that the NASDAQ built to run on top of AWS. Well, actually, they were storing all the historical market data in Amazon S3 with the pure purpose to be able to run this app. But after a while, you know, the NASDAQ started realizing that all this data that they had sitting in the cloud was useful for other companies to use as well. And so what they did, they put an API on it using a company called XNight. And now all historical market data of the NASDAQ is available on the AWS platform for anyone to use and for anyone to build applications against. So I want to close off with one last example of how people are using our pipeline, our platform, to build big data applications. In this case, it's the CDC in the US, that's the Center for Disease Control. They, for a very long time already, have been actually collecting about diseases and people that get ill in the US, and all hospitals and doctors and whatever, they're all reporting this sort of statistical information back to the CDC. But to actually share that was a real nightmare for them. Yeah, it was not an easy way for them to do analytics on it and then share it. So they moved to the cloud. They were running on AWS with a platform called BioSense 2.0. And so what's this? All this information flows onto the Amazon cloud. They do their analytics on it. And then they have a whole collaboration platform that runs on top of that, that brings this data to, on one hand, healthcare professionals, but sometimes also folks that work for the federal government or for the state government. But also, all the data is also available for individuals to use. And you get a whole rich environment in how to actually explore health data in the US. And this is sort of an example. This is a graph about how influenza happens in the US during a certain period of time. Okay, that's one of the power supplies that's gone. I have to hurry up. So with all of that, I was sort of closing off. Forrester did a deep dive on all the different platforms that are out there that provide you with sort of MapReduce and Hadoop kind of functionality. And it's obvious to everyone that the Amazon Web Services version of this, Amazon Elastic MapReduce, was superior to all the other offerings out there. And I think that's mainly due to the fact that we have a very complete offering of tools around it, but also the ease of use is really important. You do not have to worry about the execution of all of this. We will take care of that. You only have to write the programs. So to close off with a few sort of remarks around cloud. Cloud enables big data processing. Yeah, it's clear that we've established that. There's many customers doing that. Yeah, this, what's that? It enables big data collection. It enables big data processing. And it enables collaboration around big data. Because in the end, you can analyze all you want, but if you're not sharing the results of your analytics, you know, it's sort of useless. And so you have to worry about that as well. With that, remember, there is a free tier also for analytics. Get started with that. And thank you very much.